Meeting economists at parties can be quite frustrating. You might want to ask them questions about what's going to happen to the stock market, or what's going to happen to interest rates, or exchange rates, or inflation, and most of them will not know the answer. I know that because I've been to such parties myself, and I happen to be an economist. This brief guide is meant for all the relatives and partygoers that I've disappointed throughout the years for not being able to answer their questions, and for anybody who wants to find out what economics is really about. The first thing I can do is to go and ask my colleagues, because here at the LSE, I'm surrounded by economists.
I work on the economic effects of Brexit.
I study the use of behavioral economics and policy.
What's behind these different answers from market traders, firms, or households when we ask them something like what's expected inflation?
Whether policies do the same thing in different places that we try them, or whether they actually do something different and we need to moderate what we're doing everywhere we go.
If you thought economics was confusing before, you must think by now that it makes no sense, because all the topics that my colleagues were talking about seem to be highly unrelated. And yet they have something in common. The first thing that they have in common is the core topic of economics is the study of how people and firms make choices. Choices on nearly everything. On what to consume, what to buy, what to produce, whom to marry, whether to have children, how much to work, which job to do, and so on. But what really brings all economists together is the method which we use to analyze these choices. Quite simply, economists assume that people want to maximize their happiness. Very often this is misunderstood to mean that economists assume that people are selfish and only want to maximize the amount of money that they bring home. But in reality, happiness can be made of many things, such as the welfare of others or the welfare of the planet as a whole. The interesting part of the problem is that people and firms are subject to constraints. They have a limited amount of money and, most importantly, a limited amount of time. This means that time spent doing something cannot be spent doing something else. The reason why understanding behavior is important is that it allows us to tell whether policies will have the desired effect or whether they will bounce off the wrong way. Take, for instance, the apparently very simple question of what will happen to revenue if we increase tax rates. The naive answer is that revenues will go up. The naive answer is also typically wrong, because it assumes that people will keep working at the same rate. But will they? Well, they can decide to work less, they can decide to migrate, or in the extreme case, they can decide to evade taxes altogether. Once we take into account responses, the effects of the policy can be quite different. So next time that you hear a policy proposal, no matter how sensitive it seems at first, ask yourself, does it really change what people want, for instance, by providing new information? Or does it only add a constraint? In the latter case, chances are that people are going to work around the constraint, and the effect of the policy is going to be very different from what you originally intended. The tools of economics helps us understand behavior in many different settings. So if you go back to my colleagues' offices, you now can see, or at least sort of see, how it all fits together. Ricardo studies macroeconomics. He studies how all the choices of firms and all the choices of people aggregated together explain the economy as a whole. He's the one that studies money, but I've never seen him make a prediction. Swati studies international trade, how firms trade with one another across borders, and whether this benefits people or hurts them, and how the losers can be compensated by the winners. Rachael studies econometrics, which are all the tools that we use to analyze data. And Daniel studies public economics, which is the economics of the state, how the state can design taxes and transfers to make things better. And finally, I study development economics. I look at poverty in the poorest countries in the world, and I study whether people are poor because they face different opportunities or because they have different skills.
If this sounds interesting, there are a number of websites dedicated to translating economics into plain English. I hope you'll have the time to have a look at them and to try and understand what economics is about, because ultimately, we cannot change what we do not understand.